Hi everyone, thanks so much for listening to another episode of Dogman Encounters Radio. I'm Vic Cundiff and I'll be your host for the show. Before we bring on tonight's guest, if you've had a Dogman encounter and would like to speak with me about it, whether in private or on the show, please go to dogmanencounters.com and submit a report. I'd love to hear from you. If you've had a Sasquatch sighting and would like to be a guest on Bigfoot Eyewitness Radio, please go to bigfooteyewitness.com and submit a report. On last week's show, episode 258, Ryan came on and told us about dogman experiences he had when he was a kid, as well as some that he had after he grew up. Unfortunately, we ran out of time, and there were several questions I wanted to throw at him that I ran out of time and didn't have a chance to ask, so I asked him if he'd be willing to come back on tonight and answer some of these questions, and he agreed, so here we are. Ryan, thanks for coming back.
Thanks for having me, man. It's definitely a little unexpected, but good all at the same time.
Well, when you consider the great job you did explaining your experiences last week, it's no surprise the listeners liked you so much.
Man, I definitely appreciate that. I don't know about it being all that great and wonderful. you have to relive the whole experience over again. It takes its toll on you, but you know what, man? If it helps somebody else, Vic, if it gets it out there and can make people more aware of their surroundings and what's going on and that something else is out there than what we're used to, then it's all worth it, man. The comments, and I'll try to respond to a few and just kind of steer people in the right direction and try to answer some questions. So I appreciate the opportunity to be able to come back and maybe get some of those questions answered for them.
Well, it goes without saying, we're glad to have you back. Speaking of the comments, you noticed a trend in the comments that were left for last week's show that bothered you. Please expand on that for us.
Well, man, I was reading through, and I don't want anybody to take this the wrong way, or I don't want to offend anybody for sure. But reading a lot of comments on people thinking that these things are our guardians, or they're sort of warm and fuzzy, cute and cuddly. You're not going to play fetch for these things. You know, you're not going to pat it on its head and have it climb up in your lap and be your lap dog or your house dog, your yard dog, whatever. I don't want people to get that misconception at all. The thing, they had me dead to rights twice. One time, when I was hunting, and then one time when we were down bow fishing. I mean, they had me dead to rights. So they could have taken me if they wanted to. I don't know that was their intent. Maybe, the whole situation, whatever the white thing was, maybe they were there to protect me. Maybe they were watching. I do fully feel like if we're out in their territory, their area, they know that we're there. But I don't want people to get the misconception that the alpha or whatever we want to call her and the other male and then the four that we saw at the river. I don't want people to get the misconception that they were there watching us to protect us or help us. It doesn't feel that way. Trust me. It is definite dread. It is definite gloom and doom. As you say, a Charmin moment. It is definitely that moment. You don't feel at peace. You don't feel happy. If anything, it's almost sadness. It's darkness. It's definitely dread. It's fear at its finest. I mean, the scariest movie you could watch can't explain the fear that you actually feel in that moment. And, reading some of those comments, I want people to understand that. And please don't take offense to that. You're entitled to your own opinion. I saw several people saying, well, I want to see at least one. Like I said the other day, maybe you are a braver person than I am, but the experiences I've had in my life, trust me, I could go the rest of my life never seeing that. Even though I know what I saw, and what I saw is what I saw, nobody can take that from me. I wish somebody could take that from me, if that makes sense. Like, I wish somebody could tell me, Ryan, you didn't see that. Ryan, that is not what you saw. That is not what you experienced. Because for me now, I had moved on so far in my life to where it was out of sight, out of mind. And then those experiences happened again. And then it was kind of out of sight, out of mind for the last 10 years. And now here it is again. And it involves even my child at this point. It's not something that I wished he would have ever seen. It's not something I wished I had ever seen. So if you think you want to go out hunting or you want to have an encounter with one of these things, trust me, you don't, because it is absolute terror. Did I feel my life was in danger the day at the river? Yes, 100%. I felt like had Mike shot his weapon, I think it would have been over. That's my honest opinion. I don't know their intent. I don't know why they were there, but they definitely wanted us to know that they were there. And, the feeling that they conveyed to us was, hey, I'm here to scare you or create some sort of fear in your life. The one that stood up, placed his arm on the branch, you know, I've thought this over and over in my head. Maybe he was just growling or just showing his teeth. That Joker smiled at me, Vic. Straight up grinned, smiled. It wasn't just showing its teeth like a dog shows its teeth. It was almost human. It was almost like, I'm not going to say that I could say that it was thinking because I don't think that at all. But by seeing its expression and knowing people the way I do, you can tell when people want to be around you or when they don't. It for sure, I'm not saying it didn't want to be around me, but it didn't want to be my friend. It didn't want to be my buddy. I think it was straight up telling me, hey, man, you are in our area and you're going to see us. We're going to see you, but you better not make a move towards us. Now, does that mean it's going to leave us alone? I don't know, but I can tell you this. I don't ever, ever in my life want to see another one, ever. And I hope to God I don't.
Well, that makes two of us. I hope you never see one again as well. Several listeners apparently took exception to what you said about how your stepdad dealt with his coyote problem last week. Do you think you misrepresented him in any way?
I don't think I misrepresented him. I just didn't make it as clear. The thing you got to understand is our cattle was our livelihood. I mean, that's how my stepdad made his money. That's how Pop made a living. He traded cattle. He bought old cattle. He was a farmer. That was livelihood for us. And, you know, being hunters, I'm not going to sit here and tell somebody that I don't hunt animals. I do. I would hunt coyotes just because they are a nuisance animal in Alabama. If I had a choice, the deer population thriving or the coyote population thriving, I'm going to choose the deer every time, just because they are a nuisance animal. Raccoons are a nuisance animal. Possums are nuisance animals. I don't necessarily hunt coons and possums. I know a lot of my friends do, but the thing I want people to understand is he wasn't just some cold stone murderer killer either. He definitely, if what he was saying was true, and I do believe it because I've never known the man to lie to me. If what he was telling me was true, he honestly feared for his life that night. But not only that, he drives up on and sees the three there. And there's a dead animal in there, something that he bought, something that he worked for, something that he paid for. So not only was he protecting himself, but he was being a shepherd. He was taking care of his flock, so to speak. And by being a farmer and taking on that responsibility, your responsibility is to take care of that animal, no matter what it costs. If they're sick, we doctored them. If they were wounded, we patched them up. So to kill a nuisance animal was definitely something that we did, and we did regularly. I mean, it wasn't an uncommon thing for us to kill a coyote if it was clear and we had a clear shot on it. Now, I do know some people talked about, well, I can't believe he just let it suffer, things like that. You got to put yourself in his shoes in that moment. You're seeing something that is not supposed to exist. You've heard people close to you tell you that if you kill one, you're going to become it. He's got all these thoughts from what he's telling me going through his mind. He's thinking that it's going to transform back into a human. Oh my gosh, I'm going to be, tried for murder. I mean, all these things going through his mind. So there was a lot of grief involved in that, you know. So, you know, when he killed the female, she was close. I mean, close with 20 yards or better, you know, and they are showing their teeth. They are growling. They're snarling. In his mind, they're going to attack. I don't remember him saying it lunged at him or anything like that, but he did say they were definitely moving. They were definitely postured. You know, I don't remember him talking anything about their ears being pinned back or anything like that. But if you know dogs or canines at all, you know, if they're growling, showing you their teeth, they mean business. And if you get too close, they definitely are gonna give you the business end of it. You know, I know people who have dogs as their house pets, but they can't get around them when they feed them. They just get aggressive. So, He, in his mind, he's drove down. It's the middle of the night. He's got a dead animal laying there that he bought and paid for. That is his very livelihood. It's how he provides for his family. And then you've got three of them standing over it. You know, I don't know if they killed it or if the rake thing killed it, just like in the dream. I don't know, but in his mind, he's trying to process all this. But not only that, he's got these three things that are as big as him or taller. And he was 6 foot plus, 204 pounds. You know, he's a big man. And for something like that to scare him, it had to be a gut check moment. One of those moments of it's him or them, you know. So not only was he protecting his livestock and his investment, but he was protecting himself as well as the people that he loves by seeing them. So could he, when he shot the male and I said it was breathing, I don't know how long it was breathing. The way I remember the story was he stayed there with it till daylight and it was breathing the whole time. And then he went and got his tractor and he covered it up. But, you know, I don't know. Maybe he could have shot it again like he did the female. You know, he ended up shooting her three times. So, you know, maybe he could have ended it. I don't know. I do know when he shot her the first time and she fell, he said she was still breathing. She was breathing up until the moment that he got to where he put her in the silo and he shot her again, just to go ahead and make sure she wasn't coming back to life. So, you know, to paint him as this horrible person, he was not. He was a military guy. He had been in the Army. I've never talked to him about his Army stories or what he witnessed in war. Honestly, I don't even know. I guess he would have had to have been in Vietnam at least, but I never talked to him about that. I just knew that he had been in the Army. So, you know, his mind as a soldier is to obviously neutralize the situation, but his mind as a protector, his mind as a shepherd is also to protect his investment. So I don't want people to think that like he was just this horrible guy because he wasn't by any means. He was definitely rough and around the edges and definitely gruff. And there were times he cussed me like a dog, but you just kind of had to let that go in one ear and out the other because that's just what his nature was. But as far as being a violent man, he was not violent at all. He wouldn't shy away from it. He wasn't scared of anybody, that I know of. No human being ever. And I've seen him get in some heated arguments and stuff with some men at sometimes, and he wasn't going to back down, but it wasn't one of those things where he was going to be the first one to throw a punch. It wasn't one of those things where he was going to retaliate with vengeance or anything like that. It was kind of, look, this is what I'm saying. This is what I mean. If you don't like it, you need to handle it a certain way. We can do that too. But if you want to handle it like men, we can handle it like men and we can talk it out. So he definitely was not a violent man. He was definitely not somebody who just killed for sport. We deer hunted. He mainly carried me deer hunting because I wanted to do it. I don't recall him ever killing a deer in the 7 or 8 years my mom was married to him, 10 years my mom was married to him. I don't remember him ever pulling the trigger. I do remember me pulling the trigger, and I do remember him telling me always, Ryan, you got to make a clean shot. You've got to not let that animal suffer. You shoot it here and either get a lung shot, you shoot it here, and you get a heart shot, or if you can, you shoot it in the head, you end it quickly. So in that moment, in that night, I honestly think that it was fear of his life, and he thought that if he didn't shoot that thing or shoot both of them or whatever, that it was going to end him. As far as shooting the male, you know, I don't know what his thinking was. I do know he trapped it, and that was his way of dealing with it. You know, he's seeing something that is not supposed to be real, and he's trying to process it. And in his mind, you know, and I'm speculating here, but the way him talking about after he shot the female that night of the howl being more sorrowful sounding, maybe he put that together in his head. I don't know. That's the way he described it, but he definitely said it sounded different than the normal howls that he would hear. But you know, to paint a picture, maybe I did that myself, of him being somebody who just let that animal suffer, or I don't know if it's an animal, the dog man letting it suffer. I don't think that was his intent. And listening back to it, I guess it did sound that way, but you know, I was taught to never let anything, I mean, even cattle we had that we knew weren't going to make it. If he ended their life, he did it quickly. You know, it wasn't, he wouldn't let them, you know, 100% are not going to make it. He would end their life. And it was always in a manner of whatever was the least amount of suffering for that animal. So he was not a monster. It was not intentional. I think he was just trying to rationalize the situation and fix it the best he could, the best he knew how in the moment. And until you walk a mile in a man's shoes, you don't know what you would do. I can tell you what you would do if you saw this thing. The first thing you're thinking is, this thing's going to kill me, and you want to get away. And then you're thinking, well, what if I can't get away? What have I got to do? And I guarantee you, if that thing jumped on you, which it didn't jump on him. But if you're in that situation and that thing makes a move for you, you're going to be looking for something, a knife, a stick, a rock, whatever you got to do to gouge its eyes out or stab it or whatever you got to do, because, you know, we're designed to survive. I mean, that's survival instinct takes over, you know? So, you know, if I painted that picture of him, I'm sorry. That was not my intent. And I know Pop, his intent was not to let it suffer, but I guarantee, I mean, if he was here today, he would tell you the same thing. Hey man, I was in the moment and all I knew was I was dealing with something that I didn't know what it was. I've got a dead animal in there and they're being aggressive towards me, or showing signs of aggression. Somebody commented, you know, this is the stereotypical way of not dealing with a dog man and not knowing how to deal with it. It didn't show any signs of aggression. Well, it's showing its teeth to me is showing aggression. It's snarling and growling is showing aggression. Maybe that's fear. I don't know. But, you know, you've got a 300 plus pound animal that's 6 foot plus standing on its hind legs looking at you. You're thinking in the moment, number one, how do I get away? How do I survive this? Number two, what if I do have to do something to defend myself? And I can guarantee you that you're going to fight till one of them is dead. So, you know, just to defend him a little bit and not necessarily needs defending, but to defend my comment, I didn't mean to paint him like he was just some sort of animal and let that thing suffer. I think he just didn't know what else to do. It was him or them. And, in that moment, I think anybody would choose themselves over something else.
Well, it's so easy to judge the man when you weren't faced with the problems he was faced with and when he didn't experience the things that he experienced, but put yourself in his shoes and that might change the way you look at it. I wish he would have handled it differently, but I understand why he did what he did that night. Moving forward, Ryan, you said your son's still having a lot of trouble dealing with the dogman you guys saw when you were fishing that day. What more can you tell us about that?
My son is pretty quiet anyway. I mean, he's a jokester and we cut up and we have a good time. I mean, he's my best friend. I mean, to have a 15-year-old son that wants to be involved in your life, I mean, I can't get up to go to the bathroom if he's in the room with him saying, hey, Dad, where are you going? You know, so he is my very best friend and we've been best buddies since he was a baby. I mean, my wife used to get mad because he preferred me over her. Now, since then, our three other children have definitely preferred her over me. But he is hands down, next to my wife, he is hands down my best friend. So it's been tough for me to see him struggle the way he has. But at the same time, I think he's handled it pretty maturely. He doesn't want to talk about it a whole lot. If I try to bring it up, he's just like, Dad, can we talk about this some other time? I don't want to think about it. He definitely doesn't go outside at night. Like I said the other night, when he goes through the house, he turns on a light and his bathroom is right outside his bedroom door. But he said the other night that when he goes to the bathroom, he flips the hall light on, flips the bathroom light on from inside his bedroom. Like I said, he's 6 foot one or so, and he's got a pretty long reach. So he's leaning out the door, flipping lights on before he even goes to the bathroom. So it's definitely affected him. I've tried to tell him, son, I don't think these things are following us. I don't think that they're out to get us or tracking us or anything like that. I have shared the entire experience with him and I think it's a little bit hard for him to process. You know, he's asked me, he's like, Dad, how did you handle that being my age or a year younger than I am? And I'm like, you know, son, maybe I've raised you a little softer than what my stepdad raised me. I really didn't know how to process it. I just knew to do what Pop told me to do. And that's what I told him. I said, if you'll just trust me and you'll just listen to me, you know your surroundings. And I was taught from a young age, even by my grandfather and my stepfather, my uncles, to always know your surroundings. You know what's on your right, know what's on your left, know what's behind you, know the area. When you go to into a restaurant, you sit with your back facing the back of the restaurant and your eyes facing the door and you know what exits are. And I've tried to raise him the same way and tried to train him the same way. You know, always have an escape route. Always know who's around you. You know, when you're walking down the street, know the people that are around you because people, unfortunately, there's a lot of bad people in this world and a lot of people that would cause you harm. You know, I was 17 years old. I was in a bowling alley one night and, they wanted to put us up front and, we requested an alley in the back and we were there 30, 45 minutes and somebody come by and shot the place up. And the bullet holes as we were leaving come through right where we would have been standing. Now, we could have been shot. I don't know. I think it was divine intervention that God gave us enough wisdom to say, hey, have you got anything in the back? But that particular night, I don't know why those people did that. They were just stupid people. You know, they were just, maybe they were kids or gang initiation. I don't know, man, but either way it happened. And they're, by doing so, they were not very good people. They at the very least weren't thinking. And then we used to hang out in a parking lot, and I was probably 19 or 20 at the time, 18. And a guy come through one night with a shotgun, hung it out the window, and just busted a few rounds off. You know, he was just not a good person. So people, I say all that to say that people can treat you the same way that these animals could, you know, and I said, son, if they had wanted us, they had us. They had us in their sights. I mean, they could have been on us. And I said, son, they were on us and we didn't even know it. You know, had they not made a splash and you look up, we wouldn't have heard them at all. So I said, you know, the thing you got to do is just thank God for your blessings and just try to see it as a learning, teachable moment. And you know, and that's a little tough for him. Like I said, he doesn't want to go outside at night. He's not really been thrilled about getting his driver's license anyway, but he's made the comment, when I do get my license and I do get a vehicle, I'm going to be home before dark. I don't want him to live his life that way at all. So I'm just trying to take it one day at a time. If he wants to talk, I listen. I try to explain as best I can. I mean, and I don't have a lot of experience myself. Like I said, up until this moment, you know, a month ago, I had never told anybody other than my stepdad about what had happened, you know, so, and maybe that's naive of me. Maybe that's selfish of me, but you fear being ridiculed. And there's some fear right now in me even doing these interviews. You know, somebody hears my voice. They put two and two together. They know it's me. What kind of ridicule am I going to face for that? But at the same time, I feel like, you know, you've got enough listeners out there. There's been enough hits on this video. I think 35,000 hits or something like that since Friday night, that maybe it'll just cause people to be a little bit more cautious. And that's what I told my son. You know, our goal as human beings is to help people, not hurt people. We don't have to air our dirty laundry and things like that, but you know, we can share our experiences with people and try to impart wisdom into them. And that's what I'm trying to do with him. I'm just trying to impart as much wisdom as I can in him and help him understand that fear is the opposite of faith, and we are faith believing people. Our entire religion is based upon faith. And I said, you know, just as you have faith in Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can have faith that he's going to protect you. And at the end of the day, if your number's called and he wants to call you home, you're going to go one way or another. You just hope that it's quick and painless, you know? So that's hard to explain for a 15-year-old. I accept it at 40, you know, because I've lived a little longer. I still got hopefully a lot of life ahead of me, but he's even got longer, you know? So to live your life in fear is the one thing I told him that we're not going to do. We're not going to walk around like the boogeyman is going to jump out and get us. Are we cautious when we go outside? Absolutely. Are we going to allow this to keep us from going hunting? Absolutely not. Will we jump right back in it this season? I don't know. Will it be in that area? 100%. I can tell you no. It will be somewhere else, but that's not to say that there couldn't be these things on that property, you know? And I told him, I said, you know, we could be attacked by a pack of coyotes. We could be attacked by a hog. Crap, you could be attacked by a deer. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you could walk up on a deer thinking it's dead and it jump up and it maul you. So to be afraid of something because of the way it looks is definitely the wrong mentality. But you should definitely have a healthy respect for whatever it is, whether it be human being or a dog man or a deer or whatever. You should have a healthy respect that that thing has the same mentality as you, and that's survival at all costs. So, you know, I've just tried to tell him, son, just try not to live your life in fear. We're at home. We're safe. I'm here. If anything was to happen, if we did see something around the house, which we never have, it's 2 miles or so away from where my encounters were as a kid. And it's a 10 mile or 10 minute drive, probably 10 miles to Mike's house from here. I said, so I don't think they're just following us. And his comment to that was, well, Pop said, you know, that it had your scent. I don't know. That was his way of thinking. Me seeing the alpha, or what I think was the alpha, that day in the woods could be coincidence. It could not be. But I told him, I said, we're not going to live our life in fear like these things are out to get us. If they wanted us, they had us. They've had me twice. So we're not going to live that way, and we're going to take it one day at a time. And I asked him, I said, you know, do you want to talk to anybody about it? You want to talk to our pastor? You want to talk to a therapist, or even you, Vic? And he's like, no, I don't want to talk to anybody but you about it right now. I just kind of want to try to forget that it happened. And I said, well, in forgetting that it happened, always keep it in the back of your mind. You know, when you're out and about, you and your cousin go fishing, whatever, even if it's broad daylight, I said, because you got to keep in mind, that's when we've seen these things. We haven't seen them at dark. Just keep in your mind where you're at, have an escape plan if you need it, and go from there. I said, it could be a yard dog that's got you pinned up, but you should know how to get away from it, you know. So don't panic. Show it respect and back away and just try to get out of there as best you can. Don't run, you know, unless you absolutely have to. But, I mean, from what I've seen, you're not going to outrun these things anyway. So just as being as big as they are, I just feel like they would be faster than me, you know. So if that's the case, then we'll handle it. And if it's you and I that are alone and we see one, you know that I'm going to protect you at all costs. And the only thing I can ask is that you just listen to what I say. You do what I tell you to do. If it's leave me there and you go, then that's what's going to happen. You know how to shoot. You're a pretty good shot. So, you know, you have to think of it in that situation. You have to gather all your faculties, assess the situation, and try to handle it with as much maturity and level-headedness as you can. And I said, if you can do that, then you're going to be okay. I said, but the first thing you got to do is you got to conquer the fear that it's waiting outside the door, because it's not. It's not in the house. I don't know that they can get into your house. I've heard stories of them being able to jiggle doorknobs. I've never told him that. And to my knowledge, he hasn't listened to anything but the show I did the other night. And I've told him, I said, you know, you really don't need to listen to him. If you get to the point that you do want more knowledge, like I said, he doesn't really want to talk about it. He doesn't really want to discuss it. He hasn't asked me any questions other than that day. You know, Dad, what were those things? He didn't even have a lot of questions whenever I explained to him the story. But you can see he's soaking it in, if that makes sense, almost like a sponge. He's trying to take in as much knowledge as he can. But I think at the same time, he doesn't want a whole lot of knowledge, because he is fearful, which, I mean, I'm fearful of him. I don't, like I said a while ago, I don't think they're cute and cuddly, and I don't think they're waiting to play fetch with you. But is their intent to kill you? I can't say it's not, but I do know the two times that I encountered them up close, I guess if it was their intent, they would have done it, if that makes sense, Vic. I don't know what their intent was, but honestly, in my heart of hearts, I don't want to believe that they were intent on killing us that day. I do think that they very much wanted us to know they were there. I do think that that male may have been the same male that I seen with the alpha. We're in the same area. I do think that he wanted us to know that he was there. And maybe he just took the opportunity to reveal himself to Mike, because I'm sure he's seen Mike on the property. I mean, Mike is all over that property all the time. He can tell you every square inch of that. Hey, don't go here, go here, avoid this, avoid that. Step here, step there. He can tell you every inch of that property. So I guarantee you they've seen him. I think they just took the opportunity because they knew who I was, or they recognized me, and they chose to reveal themselves. And I think by revealing themselves to Mike was a, I don't want to say a bluff, but a way of saying, hey, we're here and we're bigger than you. So don't try anything stupid, if that makes sense, Vic.
That does make sense. And please make sure he knows if he ever does change his mind and decides he'd like to talk with me about it, that I'll always be here for him.
And I explained that to him, and I told him, I said, Vic, is the way you hear him on this video is exactly the way you hear him when you're talking to him personally, even outside of the interview. I said, he is so professional and so open-minded. I said, honestly, I couldn't tell you if Vic's a believer in these things or not. I said, maybe it's a money-making thing for him. Maybe he's seen them. I said, I don't know. I said, but the vibe I get from Vic is that Vic truly wholeheartedly believes every encounter that he's heard. He keeps an open mind, no matter how crazy or outlandish it sounds. He keeps an open mind, and he comforts you whenever he begins to explain or begins to share things with you. I said, so he is definitely somebody that you could talk to. We could call him. We could get him on the phone and just let him maybe break down some of the questions that you have. And he's like, yeah, you know, Dad, I appreciate that. And let him know I'm appreciative of that. But right now I don't want to talk to anybody. So we'll take it one day at a time and see, you know, how things progress in the future. And, you know, we got him a bow for Christmas. So my plans this bow season is to have him in a stand, and we're going to do it. And I'll be packing heat like I always do. I mean, I've always got a sidearm. Whether that would stop one of them, I don't know, but it'll let them know I mean business if it comes to that. But we're not going to live our life in fear. I mean, I'm going to go into the woods with the same mentality that I always do. I could run up on a hog, or I could run up on any kind of wounded animal and have to defend us. Heck, I could run up on a meth head somewhere, you know what I mean? And you said one time that everything that goes bump in the night is not a dog man. And that's the mentality that I'm taking. Every little noise I hear is not what I saw in the woods. Every stick that breaks or every leaf that crunches is not one of those things. But on the flip side, I'm going to keep an open mind saying, hey, it could possibly be. If it is, and it does present itself, how are you going to handle it? And that's the main thing I'm trying to convey to him is it's going to be all about how you handle the situation. You're not going to be alone. And he's getting to that age. He'll be 16 next year, right after hunting season ends. So he won't get to hunt by himself. And I don't know that I'll let him hunt by himself for another year or two, just because his mom, she's pretty protective and cautious of firearms and things like that. And I definitely want him to know how to handle a weapon, even though I think he does. I want to make sure that I have peace of mind that he, is responsible enough to be alone, that he knows how to climb a tree stand, or he knows how to get in out of a shooting house or a blind with a weapon. I mean, climbing a tree stand alone is dangerous. You know, I mean, you're 20 foot up in the air, you take a fall, you break your back, you can break your neck, you can break your leg, whatever, and not be able to get out and lay there for days on end and possibly die that way. So I want to make sure that he knows 100% the dangers of just everyday life. And then now you just got an added thing you got to add to it. So I think he understands that he could talk to you, Vic. And I definitely, definitely appreciate you listening to me and definitely appreciate you taking the time to say, hey, man, I don't know you from Adam. I've talked to you a couple times on the phone. I don't know your son. I've never talked to him, but I'm here if he needs a sounding board. And I know you would give us the best advice as possible. So I definitely appreciate that.
Oh, you know, you're welcome. That's what I'm here for. Bouncing back to talking about your stepdad, if he was so afraid of the dogmen, how was he able to go out and work and do the things that needed to be done around the farm if he was so fearful of them?
Honestly, I think once he shot the two big ones, I think that he had processed, okay, it's over. Like I said, the few times after they divorced that I went back to work with him, I asked him, have you seen any more? Nope, sure hadn't. Boy, we got work to do. We ain't going to talk about this. So if he saw any more after that day, up until the point that I had my encounters, I think he had just processed it and dealt with it. Now, when we spotted what we call the alpha, I think he 100% knew what it was because his mannerisms did change. He was a lot more cautious than what he was. I'd say he always had a gun. It would be in the truck or, you know, he always carried it out of the house, but he may leave it in the truck when we were working. After we had started noticing the three bigger coyotes or dogmen, whatever you want to call them, after we noticed those three, I do remember seeing him carrying that weapon everywhere he went. So I think in the back of his mind, he knew, hey, this could be happening again, but until it presents itself, I'm not going to panic. And he was a very level-headed person. Like, he didn't get riled up much unless I did something wrong. Then he lost his mind. But like I said, he was just a hard, gruff, tough man. But he was very level-headed. So I think his ability just to overcome his fear, especially after the two had died and he disposed of them, I think that he just was able to overcome that and move on. And even after when he shot one of the black ones, you know, moving forward from there and everything calmed down. I think once it calmed down, it just kind of went in the back of his mind. Okay, we dealt with it again. We're not going to see him. And then, like I said, after that, when I went back to work with him, as far as I know, he never had another encounter. So I think just mental toughness, just being the person he was, the way he grew up. I mean, he had worked since he was in the sixth grade. He quit school. So he had been working. His dad had got injured and had his leg amputated, and his dad couldn't work. So he was the oldest child, so he was having to do odd jobs and cut timber and things like that. So he had to quit school. Coincidentally, was one of the smartest men I've ever known. He knew numbers. Like, he could add figures in his head, and you could throw a number out there, and he could give you the sum of it. I mean, you could have a calculator in hand, calculate it in, and within 30 seconds or so, he could have the answer just doing the math in his head. So he was very intelligent. And I think just life experiences and knowing that he had dealt with them once and then he dealt with the black one that came through, even though we never found the body, I think he just had the mental fortitude to just push through and say, hey, I've got work to do and this is not going to stop me. And he just didn't let fear rule his life. And he was never that way. He was definitely more cautious, but he just never was one to let anything. I mean, you know, you pay $600 or $800 for a cow and you walk down there, it's dead. He was just, well, let me go get the tractor and bury it. He wasn't mad and upset and throwing temper tantrums because he lost $600 or $800 at that moment. He just said, well, we'll make it up somewhere. You know, we got to do a better job protecting them or whatever. So he just dealt with every situation as it was placed in front of him. You know, he played the hand that he was dealt, and oftentimes he did that very eloquently and the way that it should be handled. So I think he just pushed through and persevered and said, you know what, if it arises, I'll handle it. If it doesn't, then I'm going to rock on with life.
I can only imagine the things that must have been going through his head as he was walking around the farm doing the things he needed to do. That couldn't have been easy. Do you think the time when the alpha peed on your jacket had any notable effects on how you developed into an adult?
You know, that's a good question, Vic. I didn't really know how to take that. You know, his pop's thought process was it has your scent, and it did that to let me know and to let him know that it knew who I was, or maybe knew who he was. Either way, he knew or she knew who one of us was in that moment. And, you know, I thought about it a lot growing up, but I didn't put much stock into it until the night that I saw her and the other male. And like I said, if it wasn't her, I'm 95% sure it was her. Like I said, her face looked a little different, but I never had a clear view of her face anyway. When I saw her with my jacket looking through the scope, she kind of had it up over her face anyway. And then when she looked at me, she dropped it. But I was so shocked by the fact, is she looking at me? Man, this thing's looking dead at me. And then it gives the same kind of grin that the ones at the river bottom done. So I think for me, like, even processing the fact of her urinating on my jacket was in the back of my mind. When she looked at me, I knew she knew who I was. You know what I'm saying? Like, at that moment, like, there was not a doubt in my mind that she saw me. And even to the point of hearing the brakes on the bus, she cocked her head to almost like she was trying to look around me, if that makes sense. Like she just made a slight movement with her head, like she noticed it behind me. And then, you know, she dropped all fours. But I don't know that I ever really put much stock into the fact of what he said about her urinating on my jacket. I mean, I definitely thought about it and dwelled on it. But like I said, I mean, I was always kind of the good soldier. That's what he told me. So that's what I'm going to believe. And that's what I'm going to do. And it definitely made me stay on my game a little bit. I definitely was more cautious when I was by myself and when I was out and about. And, there weren't many times I was by myself. And like I said, when I was, the sun was up and I felt secure in that moment. Going back to the barn and doing work by myself at that moment was over for me. It was like, Pop, I can't. I'm not going to go down there by myself. I need you to go with me. So from that moment on, he started going with me to crush the feed unless something just happened and he couldn't. So there wasn't a lot of times I was ever alone by myself on the farm that he wasn't around. So did it shape me into who I am? I don't know. The moment I saw her again, I think shaped me into more of who I am now than then. It definitely resonated. And that's one of the first things I thought of was, oh crap, she did know who I am. You know, all those nights I thought when I heard something on the roof or when I heard creaking and popping against the house, that was her. So it definitely at that point kind of resonated with me and said, okay, man, I've got to be on my game at this point. If I'm ever alone, especially in a secluded area, and even when I cut my grass, Vic, like I'm looking over my shoulder, I'm scanning the area. So from that moment on in my 30s, my early 30s, it definitely heightened my senses even more, if that makes sense. Like I'm constantly looking around. I've always been a people watcher, but even when I'm out and about with my family, like I'm scanning, I'm watching people's waistlines. I'm watching their hands. I'm looking for weapons. I don't want to say it's made me paranoid, but it's definitely made me more aware of my surroundings, even than what I was taught to be brought up to be. It's definitely made me assess every situation with a way to get out, a solution for an exit, a solution to protect myself and whoever I'm with. Well, let me reverse that. Protect whoever I'm with, then myself, because I'm very much that guy. I would lay down on a landmine to save somebody else. So I think at that moment when I saw her again, if that was her, and I believe it was, at that moment, that really defined me as in I've got to pay better attention, even more so than what I've done in my life in the past. I have got to pay more attention. But you've also got to take into account I was 30 years old. You know, I was beginning to finally hit that stage of maturity. Even though, you know, I got married in my early 20s, I had my oldest son when I was 25. I still wasn't mature. I was still a kid in a lot of ways. So, you know, from 25 to 30, I feel like I matured a whole lot. But whenever I saw her that second time, it really kicked that maturity level, as in I'm going to always be aware of my surroundings. I'm always going to be aware of my situation. I'm going to be able to get my friends, my family, myself out and not be caught with my pants down, so to speak, ever again. You know, to the point to where if I am in a stand, even if my back, you know, when my back is turned to whatever's behind me, I constantly look behind me. I'm constantly scanning. I've even gone as far as carrying a mirror with me into the woods to be able to hold up just so I can ease it up and look without having to look behind me. And if I'm in a shooting house, I don't worry about what's behind me as much unless there's windows, you know, in the back or if the door's in the back. But I definitely lock the doors. I keep the windows closed majority of the time unless there's an animal on the field. And when there's an animal on the field, I'll lower the windows. Or unless I'm just incredibly hot, burning up and need a breeze to come through, I don't open those windows. I feel like that's just part of going through that whole experience. I keep my doors locked. I've got a screened-in back porch. I keep the glass door there locked, which if they wanted to come through it, they would. There's French doors going into my living room. I keep them deadbolted and locked at all times. I mean, if we're on the back porch, the French door is open. We can get inside in a hurry. And that's, thankfully, my wife is that way. Like, even in the garage, she locks our car doors. She's always been that way. And when we get in them to drive anywhere, she locks the car doors. So that's kind of second nature to us anyway. But for me, it's not just the second nature part. I'm just thankful that she's that way because I'm not the only one having to go behind checking locks and things like that. When we go to bed at night, she checks them, I check them, she rechecks them, I recheck them, and then we lay down in the bed, and she's like, did you lock the doors? And I was like, did you? You know, it's like, I know you locked them, and you know I locked them, so why are we even asking this question? But we definitely check behind ourselves, and I think that that moment, seeing her the second time, is what really made me that way.
Well, if having experiences like the ones you had doesn't make you diligent about security, I don't know what will. For those listeners who want to see that picture of the alleged rake you mentioned last week that looks pretty similar to the one that you saw, please tell them how they can find that again.
The way I've searched it in the past was I got on Google and I searched rake deer trail cam. I mean, it pulls up immediately. And that picture to me is fake. I 100% believe that picture is fake because what I saw didn't look exactly like that. So to call it a rake or a wraith or whatever these people are calling it, I don't know 100% if that's what it is, but that's the general consensus of what it looked like. It's white. It's on a deer trail cam. There's a couple of pictures. One of them, it's by itself. One of it, there's a deer in the background. It looks like it's reacting. I'm not an expert on Photoshop. I've used it some in my past job. And so it almost looks like something out of a video game or a movie. I don't know that it's a real picture, but if you'll look up rake deer trail cam, you'll know it when you see it. It's white. It's real gangly and skinny. It's got skinny arms, big glowing red eyes. And that kind of explains what I saw. Now, its head, was bigger. Its eyes were much bigger. Its eyes took up majority of its head. Its mouth was probably 6 inches or so wide across, like, you know, like our lips would be side to side. It was probably 6 or 8 inches wide, but didn't see any teeth that I can recall, but it's very, like, it didn't have lips, if that makes sense, or if it did, they were very, very thin, and just two little slits for a nose. I didn't notice any ears, but its eyes, oh my gosh, that is probably the absolute, I would take 1,000 dogmen overseeing one of them ever again. Its eyes were just huge and black. Like I said, they covered majority of its head. And its head was kind of bulb shaped, kind of like a light bulb. It was real big on top and then kind of smaller along the jawline. But when it, I guess, blinked, it had this covering that come down and it was visible. You could still see its eyes through it, and I related that to like an alligator or a crocodile, the sheath that comes over their eyes when they go underwater. I don't know if it's cleaning its eyes or focusing or if it's just blinking, but when they come down, it covered their entire eyes and went back up. I don't know if it can do it independently. They did. I mean, you know, just like you see somebody else blink. I mean, they may close close to the same time, and that's what I saw, or not close. That thing comes, that sheath is what I'm going to call it, come over its eyes and then went back. Its body was extremely skinny, and its skin was white, like kind of had a gray hue to it, but white, almost transparent looking. And when it moved, I almost thought it was like a deer flash, like its flag, its tail, whenever they waved their tail. That's originally what I thought that I saw. And as I honed in on it and I looked in my scope, I saw it. And like I said, it's on all four of its limbs, legs or arms. I don't know if it can stand upright or what, but to me, the way it looked was that it would move that way. And it was almost, like I said, like a praying mantis or a spider, some sort of bug. Its elbows or its knee joints, whatever, were straight up in the air, almost like it was standing pigeon-toed, if that makes sense. Its legs were cocked straight out up in the air, kind of tilted to the side a little bit, but not a whole lot. And its body kind of curved like a U-shape, like it was sitting lower than its legs. And its head was up higher than the knees or the elbows were. Not much higher, but enough to where like it was looking up and out. So that picture would be of it kind of standing upright, I guess. The way I saw it, it was on all fours, so I can't tell you if it could stand upright and walk on two legs. I don't know. I just know that I hope I never see one again. But if you Google that picture, rake deer cam or rake deer trail cam or rake trail cam, it will come up and you'll know it when you see it. But like I said, the head is totally different. But it was definitely skinny like that. It was definitely white, almost transparent. Like if you came up on it, you could see its bones. Or at very least you could see its veins, if it has veins, and by the blood that was on the field, something had veins, if that was even blood. We think it was. It was real thick and dark, dark, dark red, almost black, but I would say you could, its skin looks so thin and shimmery, like you could maybe even see its organs or its bones, but I would definitely think you could see its veins very, very well. I didn't notice any kind of ears or anything like that on it. I did see it move forward like a step or maybe a step and a half. And when it picked its leg up, it almost kind of rounded its leg, if that makes sense. Like I described it the other day, I think, as like a swimmer when they're swimming on top of the water and they're going hand over head, hand over head. That's kind of the movement or kind of the locomotion it made with one leg. And then the other leg just kind of shifted forward. And at that point is when the alpha and all stepped out. So I kind of lost. It did move more than that, but I don't know how close. It definitely was closer than it was originally, but I didn't actually see it take more than that one step, step and a half. So don't know what that thing was. A lot of people have had their own opinions of it. One person even chimed in about, I got the whole skinwalker thing totally wrong. I don't know. I don't know what it was. I'm just going off of things that was said by Scott to my stepdad. And when he referred to skinwalker, he was talking about the Dogman. You know, I don't know if that white thing was a skinwalker. I don't know if it's a wraith or a rake or whatever anybody wants to call it. Hey, I'll take clarification. You know what I mean? If you want to correct me on that, that's 100% fine. I don't know if it was an alien. I don't necessarily believe in aliens, but I know, and it's a whole nother story, Vic, but I know something else I saw when I was a kid, but I don't necessarily think that, I don't know. I don't know. I don't think it's from another world, or at least not another planet. You know, could it have come from hell? 100%, because that thing was freaky deaky, and I've never in my life seen anything else like it. Even, like I said, a Dogman is not as terrifying as that thing was. And, you know, that night, if the alpha and that other male stepped in to save me, I am 100% grateful for that. But I don't want people reading into it thinking that that was their sole purpose, that they were there to protect me. Do I think they were in the area? 100% I do. I think they might have revealed themselves to me because of that thing. Some guy posted about if it was a rake, he told a story about the CIA mission and how these guys hunted this thing down and they shot it with a .50 cal several times. And it was like 250 rounds or something like that, and it was still breathing. They killed it point blank range. So it's probably a good thing that I didn't shoot it, but I can guarantee you 100%, had they not stepped out, if it had gotten any closer, I would have bucked all five rounds that I had in my rifle off and would have tried to reload if possible, if I felt like I couldn't get out of there. And in all honesty, I don't think I would have been able to get out of there without it seeing me. The deer would have busted me for sure. So, you know, I don't know if it knew that I was there until after the alpha and the male that was with her. I say big male. His body was smaller than hers, but he was taller. He wasn't as thick, but he was taller than her. I don't know if he saw me until that moment. If her staring at me and looking at me drew its attention to me, I do know that it saw me because it looked directly at me and kind of shifted its head. I wish you could see the motion I'm making. It's real jerky. It kind of cocked its head to the left and then back a couple times. And so, you know, I don't know what that thing was, but I do know this. I would rather see 1,000 dogmen than ever see one of those again in my life. Even though I say I never want to see another dogman, I would take that sighting over that thing any day of the week. And I don't take anything that was posted as negativity or criticism. Everybody's got their own opinion and they're entitled to that. And when you put something like this out there, there's going to be speculation. There's going to be people that have their opinions, and I'm 100% fine with that. But if nobody takes anything from this tonight other than those things are not your friend, they're not your friend. They may not be there necessarily to kill you, but they're not your friend.
I would have posted that picture on last week's video, but it might be a copyrighted photo, so that's why I didn't post it. And if you'd rather have 1,000 dogman encounters than one encounter with one of those creepy things, then wow, it must have been rough to look at.
I'll honestly say, I believe out of every encounter I've had, that messed me up more than anything else. And it was terrifying to look at, but man, I've got goosebumps right now. When it blinked its eyes, just something about its eyes, Vic, I mean, they were just so big and so black, and I mean, they were paper plate sized. I mean, they were in proportion to its head, they were even bigger than its head. It looked like they were even bigger than its head. Like, I don't even really, it's hard to even grasp how they even fit on its head. They were so big. And it was absolutely creepy, like horror movie, creepy. You know, these ghost movies that they've made, it's like something you would see in that or some alien flick. I don't know, man. It was just, it was gross. And not just creepy to look at, but it was just gross. It was almost sickening to look at. It made you feel sick to look at it. And I don't think that that's anything it's emulating. I just think that it just is that disgusting looking that it just turns your stomach.
Well, listening to you describe it and hearing how it affected you, yeah, that thing must have been awfully freaky. Well, it's about time for us to get out of here, Ryan. I want to thank you so much for coming back on and answering these questions for us. I really appreciate it.
Oh, man, Vic, you're welcome, man, anytime. And if anybody out there, you know, if they've got questions or they want to talk to me, just leave a comment. I've tried to answer some as honestly as I could. And I had posted, you know, a post trying to clarify some things. And when we talked about me coming back on and just kind of clear some questions up, I went on ahead and deleted that so maybe they could hear it and understand it and get tone. Because you lose a lot in text. You lose a lot in email. You don't get the tone in the voice. You don't get the sincerity or the frustration. You don't get those things. So I definitely don't want anybody to read into anything that I've commented back as me being hateful or negative or ugly. It's not that. I just want you to understand that until you walk a mile in somebody's shoes, you can't judge them. And I can promise you from experiences in life, anytime I've ever judged somebody, I found myself doing the same thing or something worse. So before you judge somebody and you think, oh, I would have done that differently, until you're in that situation, you truly don't know what you would do. But I mean, it's okay to have your opinion. It's okay to form your opinion. But I definitely don't want anybody to think that I'm retaliating or having to defend myself. I don't have to defend myself to anybody. I know what I saw. If you don't believe me, that's fine. It does sound crazy. I get that 100%. And, you know, until I ran across your channel, I would have never, ever thought about sharing this with anybody. And if I would have known it's gotten the response that it's got, I might have even held off just because I don't necessarily want that attention I'm not seeking glory or anything like that. My main reason with even emailing you from the get-go, even filling out the questionnaire, do you want to come on the show? As I was looking at that, it said yes or no. I really was hoping or thinking maybe I overlooked something that said maybe, you know. I didn't want to tell you, yeah, I want to do an interview, because I wasn't 100% sure I did want to tell anybody else. I just wanted to kind of get your input and your insight on it and talk to somebody who maybe would believe me on these things, you know. And, you know, after talking with you the day that I talked to you, I felt better about it. And I was like, you know what? What's it going to hurt? I can remain anonymous. Nobody knows who I am. They may pick up on my voice if they do happen to know me, but I doubt it. So, you know, getting it out there, if it helps somebody else get a clearer understanding, that's good with me. I just want people to 100% take Ryan's advice on this. Whenever I'm telling you, they do not want to play ball with you. They are not your friend. They are not your protector. Even if that's what they are here for, I don't want you to think that. I don't by any means want you to think that I can go into their area, I can see them, I can try to communicate or talk to them. Somebody had made the comment, well, why don't you try to go back and speak to them and see if they speak back to you? No, I don't want that. And I don't think you should want that either. I really don't, because in all honesty, in my opinion, I think you're going to get an answer that you don't want if they do speak to you. I think if they do speak to you, it would freak you out so much. Even if they sang happy birthday to you, I think it would freak you out so much that they are talking to you. And the dream that I had, it very well may have been something prophetic or telepathic. I don't know, but I'm not saying it is. I'm chalking it up as coincidence. It was just a dream. I had had a traumatic experience and I was still thinking about it. And maybe that's how I rationalized what happened. Maybe that was the way of my mind processing why they didn't attack me instead, you know, or maybe that helped me think of a reason to justify why that they were there in that very moment and in that instance. You know what I'm saying? So I don't want anybody to take away from my video that I'm saying that you should go out and hunt these things, and you should go out and by hunting, I think if you go out with a gun trying to kill one, you're ignorant. You shouldn't do that. If you did kill one and you reported it, man, your life is going to be so different. If the government does know these things and you kill one, you know, and like I said, I'm a conspiracy guy, but I'm not crazy conspiracy guy, but I do think that if the government knew or does know about these things and you kill one, they're going to shut you up. They're not going to allow you to put it out there, and it might make your life a living heck. It might put you in a tailspin that you don't want to go in. Even if you have video or photos of it, there's going to be people out there that try to discredit it. If people really do know about them other than just people who've had encounters, if there's some higher up power that does know that these things are out there, and I even think that was Sasquatch, I think they're going to shut it down to keep people from going into a panic. And I think they think that these encounters are either lies or people's imagination. They've seen something. They think it's what it is, but it's really not. And I think that's why there's been no real pursuit. But I think the day that somebody shows up with a Bigfoot or somebody shows up with a Sasquatch, I think it's going to get shut down real quick, and it's going to be led to believe that it was a hoax or that it wasn't real or that it was something else. So, you know, my opinion is, number one, you don't need to think you're Rambo and go hunting these things, because you're not. I don't care what kind of training you have, unless you're a Navy SEAL or something like that, I don't think that you're equipped enough to go out and hunt these things as a skilled hunter. And I feel like I am a pretty skilled hunter. I'm a pretty accurate shot, and I wouldn't even shoot one of these things. And my stepdad, Pop, even told me, he said, hey, man, I got lucky. I got lucky that the male didn't attack me, and then I got lucky that I thought, well, I've got these steel traps. I can trap it and kill it. Hopefully this will work, and it did. So I think that he even in his mindset or his thinking, and he did say it to me, I got lucky. You know, I got lucky. It wasn't worse than what it was. So I think if you go looking for danger, you're going to find it. And if you're an adrenaline junkie, man, jump out of a plane. You know what I mean? Go ride a roller coaster. Heck, do anything else other than going traipsing through the woods looking for those things. And if you do happen to stumble upon one, keep your wits about you. Don't panic. Definitely don't fire upon it unless you absolutely have to, and try to get out of there. But use common sense. And trust me when I say you really do not want to see one of these things, because once you do, it's with you forever. And who are you going to tell? You're going to be just like me, coming on a radio show with a guy, even though I like you, Vic, and you're a super nice guy, My home is open to you anytime you need it if you're ever in the area. But you're the only person that I can really tell that that's not going to judge me in some sort of way. Even my close family members, even my wife is skeptical. You know, if I had told her about this before my son saw what he saw, I don't know that she would have believed me. She wouldn't have made fun of me. She might have laughed it off, but I don't know that she would have wholeheartedly 100% believed me. And I don't think you can 100% believe somebody until you see one for yourself. But Ryan is not saying to go out looking for these things and that they're your buddy and they're your protector. I honestly felt danger. I honestly felt fear. Even the moment that the alpha and the male showed up, I felt like my life was in danger either by them or by whatever the white thing was. I felt like it was over for me in that moment. So just please, please, if you take nothing else away from what I'm telling you, don't go looking for these things and don't think they're your buddy. Always be aware of your surroundings, even with human beings, because humans will turn on you quicker than anybody else. And maybe the dogmen are the same way. Maybe they have their own personality. Maybe some of them are out for blood. Maybe some of them are out and they're just killers and mean. Maybe some of them are not. Maybe they have compassion on humans. I don't know. But my 100% stance on it is that these things are dangerous. And if I ever do come in contact with one, again, I will do my best to get away from it without any kind of altercation, without trying to talk to it, unless it's, hey, buddy, we're cool, we're good, but I'm not looking for an answer. I'm not looking for it to speak to me telepathically, which I don't think can happen anyway outside of the Holy Spirit speaking to you. I don't think that they can open their mouths and physically talk to you. Maybe they can. I don't know. But I don't think that. So for me to go out looking for them, that's not going to happen. And my advice to you would be to not do it either. To heed my advice on this and just, if you see one, just process it and deal with it the best you can. And from that moment forward, don't go looking for them again.
Well, that's all very well said. Ryan, thanks again so much for coming back on the show to answer these questions for us. I really appreciate it. Thanks again so much. Have a great night. If you've had a dogman encounter of your own and would like to speak with me, whether in private or on the show, please go to dogmanencounters.com and submit a report. I'd love to hear from you.